Then on Saturday, the band let thousands of fans at Madison Square Garden listen to their as-yet-unreleased album, simply called Metallica.
It is an incredible record, and you're going to hear that when you pick it up, man.
There probably has been no other metal record that, in combination, sounded as good and had as many classic songs.
They made a record that sounded as big as any pop album.
To this day, the Black Album sells, you know, right around 1 million copies a year.
They brought in an audience who didn't have a clue about metal.
So why did I feel betrayed?
Thrash has, now to its credit, a classic all-time record.
Yeah, I threw it down the stairs. So what the hell is this? I couldn't believe it.
Anybody says a Black Album's not a good record, I
hated it.
I thought it was a sellout. I thought it sucked. This is not a Metallica record. This is blasphemy.
Metallica's Black Album is the most polarizing album ever made. Now, the reason I wanted to review this was because we are nearing the 30th anniversary of its release, and I thought it'd be fun to look back at this album and see how it has stood the test of time. I also wanted to talk about the massive controversy surrounding this album. Unfortunately, researching the controversy led me down a massive rabbit hole. So on top of reviewing this record, I will also be going in depth on the controversy. In order to do that, I feel like I need to give you proper historical context, so let's talk about Metallica's history up until the release of the Black Album. The band formed in 1981 when James Hetfield answered Lars Ulrich's ad in a local LA magazine. After recruiting a few other members such as Dave Mustaine on guitar and Ron McGovney on bass, they started establishing themselves in California's underground metal scene. After replacing Ron McGovney with Cliff Burton on bass, they signed with Megaforce Records to record their debut album. After unceremoniously replacing Dave Mustaine with Kirk Hammett,
what, no warning, no second chance?
The band released its full-length debut titled Kill 'Em All in 1983. Kill 'Em All quickly generated a street buzz in the Bay Area and beyond. After the release of their follow-up, Ride the Lightning, they completely took over the underground and were on the verge of exploding in popularity. In 1986, the band got their first taste of mainstream success with the release of Master of Puppets. The album was universally praised and peaked at number 29 on the Billboard charts. With three legendary albums under their belt, Metallica garnered a huge cult following and established themselves as the biggest name in thrash metal. Sadly, just as they finally hit it big, tragedy struck the band.
At about 5 or 6 in the morning, I heard a skidding, I heard a vibration.
I just remember hearing these loud noises.
The bus, you know, went over on its side, you know, and I kicked out the back window. It was 15 degree weather outside. You know, we're all in our underwear.
And I just knew instantly that something was horribly wrong.
WRTN in Urshel, the home of Midnight Metal, of course, tonight dedicating the entire show to Cliff Burton of Metallica, who died early this Saturday morning in a tragic auto accident.
And turn around, I could see Cliff's feet sticking out from underneath the bus.
The vision is just—it's burnt into my mind.
Cliff would have wanted us to continue, and as a tribute to Cliff's memory, it was important for us to go on.
The band decided to move on and brought in Jason Newsted to fill the void on bass. Unfortunately for him, a long hazing period began.
Jason was a scapegoat for all those feelings that we just did not know how to process.
He was such a fan. We wanted to unfan him.
We get called up to do a Justice for All and understand Metallica was my favorite band. So Lars comes in, he listens to it back a couple seconds, he shakes his head, he says, stop tape. And he goes, okay, the bass. I want you to drop the bass level down in the mix where you barely audibly can hear it.
Despite all of this, And Justice for All was released in 1988, and the band became a household name. The album peaked at number 6 and sold over 1.5 million copies by the end of that year. On top of that, they released their first music video for the song One.
Now the world is gone, I'm just one. Oh God help me, hold my breath as I wish one time.
video became a huge hit, and they won a Grammy for that same song in 1990. With all of this success, the Black Album became one of the most anticipated records of all time. It didn't matter if you were part of the mainstream audience or the underground metal scene, everybody was getting hyped for its release. After working on it for over a year, the album was finally released on August 12th, 1991, and people went nuts. It showcased a very big change of direction for the band. They had seemingly abandoned their thrash roots in favor of a simpler, more traditional heavy metal approach to their songs. With heavy anthems like Enter Sandman and Sad But True, and monster ballads like Nothing Else Matters and The Unforgiven, the Black Album shot straight to number one and went double platinum in less than 2 weeks. It has gone down as an all-time classic, and it is still to this day the best-selling metal album of all time. So why is it so polarizing? Well, because of the Black Album's enormous popularity coupled with the band's huge change of direction, a lot of diehard metalheads claim they sold out.
I hated it. I thought it was a sellout. I thought it sucked. This is not a Metallica record. This is blasphemy.
I'd hate to bust your bubble, but Metallica, they fucking sold the fuck right out, man.
It's a pretty compelling argument to make. I mean, the band built their following by playing balls-out thrash metal for an entire decade, and all of a sudden they're making bank on these mid-tempo anthems and ballads that sound like they were written by Poison? Of course, the logical conclusion here is they sold right the fuck out.
They fucking sold the fuck right out, man.
Now, I know there's a lot to break down about this controversy, but since this video is technically an album review, let's actually get to reviewing said album, shall we? This is arguably the best-sounding metal album of all time. It has a very polished, slick production value combined with the raw energy Metallica was known for. The drums in particular sound absolutely amazing. Listen to how the drums sound on their own. They sound like absolute bombs. The snare in particular has a huge pop to it, but it still has enough bottom end to punch you right in the gut. Bob Rock was able to achieve these drum sounds by placing two mics very high above the drums, and giving just the right amount of emphasis on those high mics in the mix, with just a slight touch of reverb to make it more lively. Now listen to the drums with the rest of the music around it. This is the kind of drum sound that I wish Metallica had on their earlier albums. Could you imagine Battery, or Blackened, or For Whom the Bell Tolls with this kind of drum mix? Lars's drumming may have been more simplistic on the Black Album, but this is the best his drums have ever sounded on a record, and Bob Rock should get a lot of credit for that. Another thing Bob Rock should get a lot of credit for is making sure this album had bass. Jason Newsted was infamously turned all the way down on Injustice for All, and it has remained a point of controversy for fans since Justice's release. Thankfully, Rock fought tooth and nail to make sure that didn't happen this time around.
I don't want to take the other things down because when those things were down, when I heard them, there was nothing there. It needs to be up. Those things need to be up during the shots. So I turned them up because it's the only thing there. It's the only piece of music in those shots.
And not only is the bass actually audible throughout the Black Album, but it actually sounds really fucking good. This was achieved by completely wrapping Jason in a soundproofing cocoon and tuning out any unwanted noise or distortion. You heard nothing but pure, unadulterated bass coming off that mic. And because of that, it gives the album a much thicker sound than it would have if Jason got cucked again. Just listen to Justice and the Black Album back to back. See how this album sounds way beefier? That's because Bob Rock turned that fucking bass up. Now, the way the bass was recorded is a sharp contrast to how the guitars were recorded. They were recorded in a much more open area, like behind the soundboard or in the main studio. This worked for the guitars because it allowed for a lot more natural reverb to go into the mics. For a guitar-driven band like Metallica, you want the guitars to breathe and feel alive, and the way Rock recorded them did exactly that. Every note, every chord, every riff, and every solo completely fills the room. And the same goes for the vocals. There was plenty of layering going on with Hetfield's vocal tracks.
Can I find it in you?
Again, harmonies, which I'd never done on previous records.
It works well here because it accomplishes what Rock wanted to do with the Black Album. When Rock came in to produce this album, his goal was to capture Metallica's live sound on a record, which he felt had never been done before.
I had bought the Justice album, so I listened to the record, and it was just no bottom end, and I'm going like, okay. I went to see The Cult, and I stayed for Metallica. And what I saw in Metallica was not the sound of Justice. I heard this big band that had weight and size, and they flew up to Vancouver and we had a meeting.
He basically sat down and was like so brutally honest with us. You know, he sat down and said, I've seen you guys play a bunch of times live and I've listened to your records. You guys have not captured what you do live on a record yet.
And in my opinion, he captured that atmosphere very well. I mean, you be the judge. I think Rock got as close to their live energy as he possibly could have. And even though the Black Album was meant to capture the feeling of a live performance, it still has a very clear, pristine production value that you would expect from a pop album. You can hear and feel every single instrument and every single vocal line on the record. Yet, as slick as this album is, it's still as loud and as heavy as any other metal album at the time. Bob Rock was able to strike a fine line that very few producers were able to strike. He made an album that sounded professional enough for radio, but heavy enough for metalheads. No matter what you may think of the Black Album musically, you can't deny that Bob Rock did an absolutely phenomenal job producing it.
Mike? Oh,
for fuck's sakes, what?
How can you suck Bob Rock's dick like that?
Because he killed it on this album?
No, you're wrong.
What?
Bob Rock is the worst thing ever to happen to metal.
What the fuck are you talking about?
Bob Rock ruined Metallica.
Jesus fucking Christ, shut the fuck up. Okay, I'm about to completely blow my fucking lid off here, because the metal community has given Bob Rock the J.J. Abrams treatment, and it's such fucking horseshit. He's always been labeled as this guy that ruined Metallica. How did Bob Rock ruin Metallica with the Black Album? Because it sounded good? Because you can actually hear the bass? Unlike on Justice, which you fucking elitist parasites constantly bitch about not hearing any bass on? I guess making sure you can hear every instrument on the album ruined the band.
No, Mike. He ruined the band because Metallica was thrash, and he was a glammy pop producer who came in and turned them into a pussy radio rock band.
Oh my fucking god! So Bob Rock apparently was this snobby pop producer who came in and completely changed Metallica's direction from thrash metal gods into alt-rock posers or whatever the fuck. I mean, I can slightly understand why this blasphemous change of direction can be pinned on him if you don't know the facts, but those facts that none of you ever bothered to learn about was that he was the furthest thing from a pop producer. He got his start working in the Canadian punk scene. He worked with bands like the Young Canadians and the Subhumans. Heck, his ultimate goal in life was to produce an album for DOA, which he finally got to do in 2008. He even worked with a couple of hard rock and metal bands before he made the Black Album. I mean, yes, his stint with the Payolas may have made him look like a cheese ball. And yes, those bands he worked with don't exactly have the same intensity as a Metallica or a Megadeth, but to paint this picture that he was some goody-two-shoes pop producer is just untrue and fucking stupid. And then there's this dumbass narrative that he came in and single-handedly turned Metallica into a radio rock band. Once again, that is not true in the slightest. The truth is, by the end of the Justice tour, they felt like they had peaked with their thrash sound, and so they wanted to change their direction themselves.
We had finished the Justice tour about 9 months before, and we really felt that there was something specific that we wanted to do, which was to sit down and try and write simple songs compared to where we'd been before.
It was what we needed to do for our own sanity, because if we had made Injustice Fall Part 2, then that would have been the sellout.
Changing their style to a more simplified sound was a decision that was made long before Bob Rock ever came into the picture. They already had 4 fucking demos written before they brought him on, and there wasn't really much about those demos that was changed. Well, except for this. But the point remains, Bob Rock had nothing to do with Metallica changing their style. They brought him in because they liked his work with Motley Crue, and they thought he would be a good fit for the album they had in mind. And you know what? They were right. And guess what? There were things about the album that he made better. Like, for instance, the solo on The Unforgiven.
Delete that.
Yes, the original solo was ass. However, Bob Rock pushed Kirk.
He's gotta fucking eat, sleep, and breathe this fucking solo until it's done. I'm just saying, let's fucking get guttural and build it to a peak.
And the result was this. See? Way better. And you know what else he improved upon? Sad but true.
I noticed that every song was in E. Why is everything in E? And James looked at me and he says, it's the lowest note. Well, I said, detune down to D. So they detuned down to D, and the next song was Sad But True. And they just played it once and they were just like, holy fuck.
Changed the tuning to D, and the result was arguably the heaviest song Metallica ever wrote. And one more thing. If Bob Rock's sole intention was to turn Metallica into a commercial sellout poser, sellout commercial false metal poser band with this album, then why the fuck did he want Holier Than Thou, arguably the thrashiest song on the Black Album, to be the first single? Yes, that's the first song he felt people should hear from this record. Not Nothing Else Matters, not Enter Sandman, it was Holier Than Thou.
What happened is when we cut the tracks, I remembered Lars saying, well, Sandman's a single. And I'm going like, what? I didn't get it yet, but I was thinking Holier Than Thou only because that kind of energy on Holier Than Thou was up tempo. And what do I know?
So how did he ruin Metallica? By making the album sound good? By making Unforgiven solo the best it could be? By making Sad But True heavier? By making sure the album had an actual bottom end to it? By making the drums sound like atom bombs? By actually doing his fucking job as a producer and creating one of the best sounding albums of all fucking time? Please explain to me, how the fuck did Bob Rock ruin them?
Well, you're a poser.
Yeah, that's what I thought. Look, I know a lot of people hate the Black Album.
I hated it.
And it's totally fine if you do, but Bob Rock is not the reason you should hate it. He did nothing wrong during the production of these albums either. And that includes the garbage can on Saint Anger. These are Metallica's albums at the end of the day. So no matter how much Bob Rock fights them on things, if that's what they want, he's gotta produce it. Bob Rock did nothing wrong. Let's continue on with the review now, shall we? The music on this album is badass. I know some people aren't fans of this album's more simplistic style.
I hated it.
I thought it was a sellout. I thought
Metallica. But I think it really works here. We all know the big riffs on this album, like the main riffs of Sandman or Rome, or the beautiful acoustic licks on The Unforgiven and Nothing Else Matters, and even the opening bass riff on My Friend of Misery. But what about some of the more overlooked guitar parts? I'm talking about that heavy as fuck main riff on The God That Failed. That riff is straight out of hell. Given the meaning of this song, it almost feels like James was screaming at the sky with his guitar. What about this lick from The Struggle Within? Good old-fashioned thrash chugging from a band that apparently stopped being thrash on this record. Or, my personal most underrated riff from the Black Album, this ultimate badass bridge from Through the Never. That riff is so fucking awesome. In fact, it's so good, I'm surprised that metal elitists don't give Mustaine credit for it. And what about the solos? I've already touched on Kirk's solo for The Unforgiven, but his solo work is almost just as good for the rest of the album. His solos on Rome in particular are fucking great. The way he slows down during these halftime bars is one of the most epic moments on the album. There's also his awesome lead work during The God That Failed, The Struggle Within, Of Wolf and Man, and of course, I can't forget when he completely masturbates his wah pedal during Don't Tread on Me. That is the Kirkest moment to Kirk on the Black Album, but it works so fucking well. And Crick isn't the only guy busting out some beautiful solos. James has his time to shine during Nothing Else Matters. Regarded as the best pure rhythm player in all of metal with a right hand faster than a cheetah on steroids, but it's moments like that, where he slows down and gets super melodic, where he shows just how gifted he really is.
I'm not sure how becoming a pussy sellout shows how gifted you are, but okay.
Fuck off! Alright, elsewhere on the album is Jason. Unfortunately, he only has one songwriting credit on the album, but he really took advantage of it. It may be his only creative contribution to the Black Album, but he was given his moment in the blackened sun, and he knocked it out of the park. This is a beautiful bass melody that would have made Cliff Burton very proud.
How would it have made Cliff Burton proud, Mike? Metallica died with him.
Oh, really?
Oh, fuck yeah. That song's fucking awesome.
You know that song was written after Cliff died, right?
Well, yeah, but Metallica died in 1989.
You just said they died with Cliff.
They did.
What? Fucking idiot. Jason was also given time to shine as a backup vocalist. The band must have noticed how fucking metal he was during the Justice tour. And they decided to give him some opportunities to bark on this record, most notably on Wolf. The reason why this works so well for me is because of the theme of this song. I like to interpret Of Wolf and Man as an analogy for playing live. In this 2014 interview, James talked about being in the zone.
I think being on stage is a different hat. It's a different mindset. It's a different space. It's, to me, time stops. There's no pain. It's like artists talk about being in the zone. That is the zone. I could get in that zone even here, just sitting playing and forget you guys are here. It somehow, the world goes away.
And I think the wolf in this song is a metaphor for that zone. So when Jason is barking, back to the meeting, before James repeats the line, it's as if it's James's conscience telling him it's time to... Introspective lyrical themes like that are prominent throughout the Black Album. James is drawing more from his own demons than he ever had before. Take Sad But True, for example. It seems to be about James coming to terms with his own self-destructive personality. It's as if he's speaking with his own subconscious and blaming it for all of his problems, only to realize this side of him was him all along. I'm insane, open your eyes. Most of the lyrics on the album invoke a similar theme about being your own worst enemy. The Struggle Within talks about how fear of rejection and fear of failure holds him back. So many things you don't wanna do. What is it, what have you got to lose? While everyone else leaves him in the dust. Advantages are taken, not handed out. While you struggle inside your head. Hetfield draws from his own upbringing as well. We did get a glimpse of it on Dyer's Eve from the Justice album, but the Black Album takes an even deeper dive into the most uncomfortable parts of James's psyche. You can see this on The God That Failed. It's about his mother who refused cancer treatment because of her religious beliefs, and you can feel James's anger as he's singing these words. Even though it's an amazing song, I can definitely understand why Metallica barely plays it live. I can't imagine these are feelings that James wants to revisit too much. The most powerful example of James writing about his childhood is The Unforgiven. The song is about a character, it's actually James, who is born into a very strict environment, and his individuality is almost immediately taken away. By the end of the song, this character, James, builds so much resentment towards the people that raised him like this that he can never forgive them. You never made a little you, so I don't be unforgiven. So my interpretation of the song is that it's about James's upbringing and how it basically just broke him in every way imaginable.
Well, my interpretation of the song is that it's a sellout ballad.
Oh, God fucking damn it! Okay, You. Yes, you. The person watching this. I want you to grab a pen and a paper, okay? Have you done that? Okay, good. Now I want you to take that pen and start writing on the piece of paper about the worst moments of your childhood with it. This might take you a bit, so you can pause the video if you'd like. Okay, you're done? Awesome. So now, imagine sharing what you just wrote with the entire world and having a bunch of mouth-breathing assholes calling you a sellout for writing it. This is one of the most profound songs I have ever heard. It was such a big change for James vocally as well. He famously blew out his voice before he had to record vocals for the album, so he ended up having to retrain himself with the help of a vocal coach. It must have been really tough for James to retrain his voice like that, and I can't imagine what kind of hell he must have dug up to write this song. It was a huge risk in every way imaginable, but it paid off. Another huge risk that paid off was Nothing Else Matters. This was a song that James wrote about an old girlfriend, but he never intended it to be a Metallica song. It was only once Lars heard it that they decided to make a demo for it. It is a love song through and through, and it talks about how close James felt with whoever this girl was despite being out on the road. It showed a very tender, loving side to James that I'm sure he was very terrified to express.
Because the guys in Anthrax and Megadeth would just like tease him so much if it was melodic and nice, right?
But it really paid off here. Is it my favorite ballad? No, it's not even my favorite ballad on the Black Album, but it is an absolutely beautiful song that, incidentally, connected with a lot of people, and it resulted in arguably Metallica's biggest hit. One of the reasons it became Metallica's biggest hit is because of the unbelievable restraint Lars had on his drums. He drives the song with a very basic beat in 6/8 time. It's a perfect microcosm for the rest of his drumming on the Black Album. Nothing complex, nothing fancy, just holding the beat down and giving the songs what they need. I know a lot of people in the metal community and the drumming community especially like to give Lars a lot of heat, and while it's definitely not unwarranted, I think all of that criticism is completely missing the point. He's not supposed to be some virtuoso like Buddy Rich or Neil Peart. He's more in line with drummers like Phil Rudd, or Brad Wilk, or Paul Mazurkiewicz. He's the drummer for Metallica, and in my opinion, nobody else is more qualified to do that job. He knows exactly how to complement the guitars and vocals, and let the music in front of him breathe, and the Black Album is no exception. I also really like this halftime beat on Rome. The guitars are hanging on a lot of open chords during the verses, and Lars's incorporation of the toms in this beat complements those chords perfectly and puts you in a trance. His use of the toms is also prevalent in Enter Sandman. This leads me to talk about another reason Lars fits perfectly in Metallica, because of his ability to structure the songs. This buildup is perfect in Sandman, and when the full main riff kicks in, he bangs his crash cymbal and makes that riff explode. He also did something genius with this riff. Do you know what it originally sounded like? It wasn't until Lars heard it and told Kirk to repeat the first bar a few more times that this riff became the 90s version of Smoke on the Water. Just watch any making of documentary Metallica has, and you'll see just how much Lars contributes to the band. If there is no Lars, there is no Metallica. All those amazing songs from this band that you adore would not even exist without him. And with that, let's talk about the songs and the album as a whole. Is the Black Album Forest greater than the trees? Well, there is not a single forgettable song on the album, but there are some issues I have with a few tracks in the overall context of the album. Let me explain. I really love track number 6, which is Don't Tread on Me. It's a great song on its own. It's got a cool intro, the main riff and chorus is pretty catchy, I like the clever use of the 6/8 time signature, and the lyrics feel very patriotic. The title, of course, is based off a colonial flag, of which the snake from said flag is on the album. It evokes that great American attitude of, don't fuck with me or I will end you. And that's where my problem with it lies. It feels very out of place on the Black Album. As I've already explained, the lyrical themes on the album are psychological and introspective, so it's kinda jarring to be smacked in the face with a song that's essentially America, fuck yeah.
America, fuck yeah!
Maybe I'm interpreting the lyrics a little too literally here. Maybe the song is actually about how Metallica themselves won't let anyone tread on them. But to me, it just seems out of place. The other issue I have is My Friend of Misery. It's the second to last song on the album, and that spot was usually reserved for an instrumental as it was on Puppets and Justice, and on the Black Album, it was, according to Jason, supposed to be the same deal. But at the 11th hour, the decision was made to add lyrics to it.
I was hoping it was going to end up being the instrumental song from the Black Album. I thought we were gonna follow suit and keep having an instrumental song. We didn't, so that's how it worked out.
The elitist crowd likes to say that lyrics were added because Metallica wanted to be more commercial, but that makes no fucking sense. Because if they wanted to make this song more commercial, why didn't they ever release it as a single? I don't know. My best guess is they just thought it was an inferior instrumental for them and thought it would work better with lyrics. Or maybe they just wanted to fuck with Jason some more, I don't know. While I do really love the song itself, it absolutely should have been the instrumental on the album. It could have been a beautiful, melodic trance before punching you in the face with the struggle within. All that being said, though, it doesn't stop the Black Album from being Metallica's fifth consecutive genre-defining classic. It was a huge risk to take themselves in this direction, the same way it was a huge risk to write Fade to Black on their second album, or to finally make a music video after putting off the idea for so long. But like everything else they did up until that point, it paid off. The album was a huge success, and it not only catapulted them into mainstream superstardom, but it introduced heavy metal to a whole new audience that otherwise would have never known it existed.
In other words, they sold out.
No, they really didn't.
Are you fucking kidding me, Mike?
No, I'm not.
They made this album to be more commercial and appeal to all the posers. End of story.
No, they fucking didn't. Did you even listen to anything I've said in this review?
Metallica sold out. Accept it.
Oh, for fuck's sakes! Alright, I put this off long enough. It's time for me to completely destroy this whole fucking sellout garbage. Here we fucking go.
Yeah, yeah!
I've already said it once in this video, and I'll say it again. Metallica did not sell out with the Black Album. Period. Exclamation point. Yeah. So in order to move forward here, I guess I have to define what selling out is. So let's get a fucking dictionary. Okay, found one online. Number one, an act or instance of selling out. Okay, what's selling out then? Number two, an entertainment, as a show or athletic event for which all the seats are sold. Oh fuck, Metallica sells out every place they play. Shit. Well, I guess that proves me wrong. Metallica did in fact sell out. You win, video's over. Just kidding. Next. Number three. A person who betrays a cause, organization, or the like. Well, a lot of metalheads did feel betrayed.
Why did I feel betrayed?
So this one could technically fit. However, I don't believe they betrayed anybody, including themselves, by just doing what they wanted to do. So that shoots this one down. And finally, number four. A person who compromises his or her personal values, integrity, talent, or the like for money or personal advancement. So that is what some online dictionary defines as a sellout. The problem I have here is I just fundamentally disagree with the whole fucking concept. What this definition doesn't say is that your personal values change over time. The stuff you were against doing one year might be something you're all for doing another year. Another reason I disagree with the whole fucking term is that compromising is a part of fucking life. When you're in a collaborative environment like Metallica is, there is natural give and take. One side wants one thing, another side wants another. If they refuse to compromise, then Metallica as a whole would not fucking exist. They'd be some no-name band from the Bay Area that broke up before they even made a fucking album. And even bands that are celebrated as bands that never sold out made fucking compromises to keep their careers going too. Do I have to bring up all of Cannibal Corpse's censored album covers? Compromising is a part of fucking life. If meeting people halfway is selling out to you, then congratulations on never never having a girlfriend or a real job, I guess. However, that being said, I'll humor the sellout parrots here. So the definition that fits Metallica's case the best is definition number 4, where they compromise their integrity, blah blah blah. Okay, when did they do that? What were their personal values, and when did they go against them? Cause I hate to break it to you, but they sure as shit didn't do that with the Black Album. The Black Album was an album they wanted to make, and the decision to make the album had nothing to do with wanting more money or fame. I know I've already said this, but I'll say it again. They felt like they had reached a breaking point with Justice. They felt like they had gotten too intricate and too progressive for their own good. They wanted to simplify things on the next album, not because of money, but because they didn't want to make another Justice.
We just felt that there was nothing more we could do. We had a fear of repetition, and we had a fear of getting stuck, and we saw with some of the other metal bands that were our peers, and there was a kind of a status quo element, a sameness to it, that that we just felt was not for us.
So if they wanted to make the Black Album because that was the album they wanted to make at the time, how is that compromising anything? Now I know what you're gonna say.
They slowed down their sound with the Black Album. It wasn't as thrashy.
Well, okay, yeah. But does that make them a sellout?
No!
And guess what? Playing simple, heavy, mid-tempo songs was nothing new for the band on the Black Album. If you look at the first 4 albums, you can easily make an entire Black Album Part 2 2's worth of non-thrashy songs. Tracks like For Whom the Bell Tolls, Escape, The Thing That Should Not Be, Leper Messiah, Orion, Eye of the Beholder, Harvester of Sorrow, To Live Is to Die. Heck, I'll even argue that Seek and Destroy and Jump in the Fire off Kill 'Em All could have easily fit on the Black Album. And guess what else? The Black Album still has a few fast-tempo thrashy songs, like Holier Than Thou, Through the Never, and The Struggle Within. Yeah, they may not be as aggressive as Damage Incorporated or Blackened, but they're still pretty upbeat and energetic. They just wanted to make more songs that sounded like For Whom the Bell Tolls and less songs that sounded like Fight Fire with Fire. How is that selling out? And while they did in fact slow down their sound overall on the Black Album, they didn't slow down that much. The average BPM on the Black Album is 114. The average BPM on the first 4 albums is 152.5, the difference of 38.5 beats per minute. To put that into perspective, the tempo drop off between Slayer's Rain and Blood and South of Heaven is 61 beats per minute, and Slayer is constantly celebrated as a band that never sold out. So if Metallica sold out by playing slower songs, then I guess Slayer sold out too. And I know the argument you're gonna make now is that these songs Metallica made were trying to be hit singles. Slayer, while they slowed down, was still being Slayer. Metallica was trying to make hit singles? Like what, these classic 1991 chart toppers?
Everything I do, do it for you.
Okay, I was being a little sarcastic there, but you know what? I will humor you elitists right now. Let's take an actual look at the music scene in that time period. As fate would have it, 1991 turned out to be a watershed year for music, based on this album. ...1991 saw grunge and alternative become the next big thing in rock and roll. The thrash and glam bands from the 80s were about to get completely destroyed. And one of the arguments I always hear is that the Black Album was trying to capitalize on the popularity of this music. It's a compelling argument to make. However, like I've already said, the decision to simplify their music was made long before the alternative scene took over. They made this decision at the end of the Justice Tour in 1989. Now, there was an interview with Kirk Hammett where he said he was hugely influenced by Soundgarden's Louder Than Love, which led to him creating the Enter Sandman riff. And this is a smoking gun that elitists used to prove that Metallica was trying to capitalize on the alternative scene and thus selling out. First of all, Louder Than Love peaked at number 108 on the Billboard charts, and Justice for All peaked at number 6. If they wanted to capitalize on the popularity of whatever fucking scene, then they would have rewritten Justice. Second of all, being influenced by your contemporaries and incorporating those influences into your music does not make you a sellout. If it did, then I guess all of Metallica's 80s albums are sellouts too, because those were influenced by contemporaries like Motorhead, The Misfits, Iron Maiden, Black Sabbath, Diamond Head, Anti-Nowhere League, and so on. Rush was heavily influenced by new wave bands like The Police in the 80s, which they incorporated into their sound. And yet Rush is constantly praised as a band that never sold out.
We all loved the music of that time. We were young enough to, and we didn't have any protective nature of what Rush was, that it could never be allowed to be influenced by new wave music or could never use an African rhythm. There was no such thing as that doesn't suit Rush.
So if Rush never sold out by changing their style based on what was influencing them at the time, then neither did Metallica for doing the same fucking shit. Now the last big argument that elitists use when they call the Black Album a sellout is the ballads. As if writing ballads was anything new for Metallica or even metal as a whole. I've already explained how stupid it is to claim The Unforgiven as a sellout ballad. Yeah, I'm sure James totally spilled his guts out and wrote about his fucked up childhood for the purpose of making money. That being said, Nothing Else Matters seems a lot more like a sellout ballad on the surface. I mean, it's a love song, it has mostly clean guitars, it has clean vocals, and it follows a very linear structure. The thing is, the argument that it's a sellout ballad completely falls apart the minute you start to actually think about it. Clean guitars are nothing new for Metallica. They had clean guitars on Kill 'Em All, for fuck's sakes. And while a love song is definitely new for the band, it's something that developed organically. James wrote it for his girlfriend at the time. It was a song he wanted to write. Now, he didn't think it would make for a good Metallica song, but the rest of the band thought it would. So it ended up being a song that they wanted to make. It was something they wanted to do. And if they were playing the music they wanted to play, how is that selling out? And one more thing I have to say before I move on. What is so bad about attracting new fans? One of the things metalheads actually complain about is that the Black Album brought in a bunch of new fans who had no idea Metallica already existed for a decade at that point. And they complain that mainstream pop fans were getting into Metallica.
When you're part of a movement and a scene, and you're there when it's in its infancy and it's in the underground, and then all of a sudden your sister, who was listening to Duran Duran, wants to borrow your Metallica Black Album, you're like, whoa. And you reassess whether what you love so much is still cool.
I remember going with my buddy to some dance club, don't ask me why, and I'm like freaking out. I'm going, this is Metallica, they're playing Metallica at a dance club, what the hell's going on here? This isn't right.
Oh no. People who like different genres of music like Metallica now?
Oh my god, what a fucking nightmare.
I do not understand this fucking toxic mentality. Please explain to me how the metal scene growing is a bad thing. How does this affect your life in any way? What is so bad about hearing a metal song in a place that doesn't play metal? Seriously, tell me in the comments. I'm all ears. They had no control over how popular the Black Album became. The Black Album was just a result of Metallica coincidentally making the right album at the right time. They didn't intentionally make it to be popular. These were all songs that they wanted to write on an album they wanted to make. That is not selling out. They couldn't help that it connected with a lot of people. So no, the Black Album is not a sellout at all. Case fucking closed.
But what about everything else, Mike? What about Fade to Black? What about the music video for One? What about Load and Reload, Mike?
Oh, So when I originally planned this video, I was only going to talk about the sellout controversy as it pertained to the Black Album. However, while researching this whole sellout crap, I found out that this controversy goes way beyond the Black Album. So for the remainder of this video, I will be tackling every fucking instance of this controversy that spans Metallica's entire career. Let's put this shit to bed. So I've researched this whole thing to an unhealthy level, and surprisingly, the closest Metallica has ever come to selling out is on their first two albums. Yeah, shocking, isn't it? However, just like the more infamous moments of this controversy, the sellout argument falls apart under the slightest weight of logic and scrutiny. The first item on the sellout card is Kill 'Em All. Yeah, the album title itself. Do you know what this album was originally supposed to be called? Metal Up Your Ass. Metallica was planning on releasing it as is. However, at the 11th hour, Megaforce kingpin Johnny Z suggested they change the name as he was concerned record stores would not put that album on the shelves. In response, Cliff Burton said, and I quote, "Those record company fuckers, kill 'em all!" Lars heard the words "kill 'em all" and thought, "Hey, that's a great fucking title!" And they then changed the name to the Kill 'em All we all know and love today. So this little moment that I just talked about has actually been interpreted by the elitist crowd as a sellout moment, because Metallica didn't fight for the title they wanted, and instead bowed to the record companies and changed the name. It seems like an open and shut case that they sold out here, right? Well, it sure does seem like that, until you actually fucking think about it. Johnny Z was only concerned that the distributors and record chains would have rejected it. He didn't know for sure if they actually would. Based on what I've researched here, it sounds more like he advised them to change it and didn't actually force them to change it. The decision by Metallica to change the title only came once Cliff muttered those immortal words. And it's not like they changed the title to something completely family friendly either. Kill 'em All is a fucking badass title. And also, while Kill 'em All is not the original title they had in mind, it was still, at the end of the day, a title they wanted for the album. So regardless of the hoopla that happened with Metal Up Your Ass, if Kill 'em All was the title they eventually wanted for the album, how is that a sellout? What personal values did they fucking compromise here? Were they ever against taking people's advice? Were they ever against changing their minds? They did not sell out by taking Johnny Z's advice and changing the title to something equally as rebellious and badass. Moving the fuck on! So the next sellout thing is on Ride the Lightning with the song Fade to Black. Why? Because it's a ballad. Oh god, no. They made a song that wasn't 1,000 miles an hour? They made something slow, heartfelt, and melodic with acoustic guitars? Acoustics and thrash metal? This song was not a sellout move in any fucking way. James wrote this because of how powerless he felt over his equipment being stolen in January of 84. It was a song he wanted to write. It was a song the band wanted to play. This is not selling out. The ballad was an experiment that paid off. And I know what you're gonna say now. The reason it's a sellout is because they said they'd never make a ballad. Well, I'm reverse Uno-ing that argument because I actually did research, and at no fucking point were Metallica ever against making ballads. I've checked thoroughly. I've looked for interviews during this era everywhere. Where the fuck did this "you'll never see Metallica make a ballad" crap come from? This quote did not come out of the band's mouth. Nothing about Fade to Black is a sellout. Next. All right, I'm about to talk about the closest Metallica ever came to selling out in their entire career, and that is with the song off Ride the Lightning called Escape. Oh my God. I've researched this whole thing thoroughly and found a lot of conflicting stories. If you read the information on the song on Wikipedia, it sounds like Megaforce forced Metallica to write a hit single. Then there are interviews with Lars and Kirk where they said it was an attempt to write something more radio friendly. But if you listen to this interview with James, it sounds like it was a last minute filler.
I remember we had all the songs, and there was, and Lars said, they want us to record one more. They need one more for the album. It's like, you didn't tell me that, so now we have to record a song.
Well, either way, Metallica did not sell out with Escape. Wikipedia says that Megaforce forced a hit single on Metallica, so based on this information, it sounds like Metallica bowed to Megaforce and thus sold out, right? Well, joke's on you, because I read the book that Wikipedia sourced this info from, and I hate to say it, but it sounds like Wikipedia pulled the whole record company wants a hit single thing out of their ass. There is no evidence in this book, or anywhere else, that says Megaforce wanted a hit single. And if you watch this interview with James, it sounds more like they just wanted an extra song, and not necessarily a hit single. And if James is telling the truth here and it was a slap-together filler song, it was still Metallica's slap-together filler song. It's their song that they made on their own. However, if you believe Lars and Kirk in this story and they wrote a song to be more radio-friendly, well, sorry to say, but it's still not a sellout. So you have Lars and Kirk explaining in these interviews that it was their attempt to write a radio song. So on the surface, it sounds like a sellout. However, read what they fucking say. We thought of it in the spirit of Iron Maiden's Run to the Hills or Judas Priest's Living After Midnight. So instead of turning it into an 8-minute seek and destroy type of thing, we kept it on the short side. And then Kirk over here says, at the time, we thought we'd write a song that was a little more accessible and melodic and less metal and grinding. Do you see the point I'm trying to make here? Yes, it was a song they created to try and get on the radio, but it was still a song they wanted to make. Regardless of why they wanted to do it, if they're doing what they want, how is that selling out? People like to say Michael Bay's a fucking sellout because he makes his movies to intentionally appeal to a wide fucking audience, but if his personal values are all about making money and these are the movies he wants to fucking make, how is he selling out anything? Do you see the fucking point I'm making here? What personal values did they compromise here? Were they ever against being on the radio? Were they ever against making something radio friendly? I've looked everywhere. None of them ever said they were against doing something like that. They might have regretted making something radio friendly after making it, and that's why they've played it live only once, but it was still something they wanted to make at the time. Escape is not a sellout. And the next sellout item up for debunking is the music video for One. And how did Metallica sell out here? Because they made a music video. Oh fucking no, they made a music video. I guess Anthrax and Megadeth sold out too, because they made videos before Metallica did. And I also guess Iron Maiden sold out with all their videos, and Judas Priest sold out with all their videos, and insert metal band here sold out with all their videos. This is so fucking stupid. Making a music video does not make you a sellout, and music videos aren't much fucking different from Metallica letting bootleg videos be recorded at their concerts. And guess what? If you want to fucking argue that they were against making music videos and they hurt my feelings and then I'm sorry to say, but they were never against making videos. Okay, Lars was asked here if they'd make a music video. Listen to his answer, and I mean actually fucking listen to it.
Well, it's like in the music business these days, there's this whole thing going around with when you release an album, then the first cut that's released to the radio station, you have to go do a video for that. And the question at the end of the day is why? And with MTV cutting back on metal, like which they did back in January anyway, the chances of Metallica video being seen to any big number of people anywhere was so slim.
At no point in this answer did he ever say Metallica will never make a music video. What he actually said was they see no reason to do one at that point in time. Now listen to these interviews with James, where he's also asked about music videos.
I was afraid of the video. You know, whenever we'd turn on MTV, maybe Asia or some Toto or something, and that, you know, the perception was, okay, we're joining that.
Yeah.
And when we didn't want to join that.
We're actually very close to doing a video for a track off Ride the Lightning. We were very close to doing one on the Puppets album, and just kind of in the 11th hour, we just kind of backed out of it. And then finally on the Justice album, we just went for it. And now I kind of like it. We did a, you know, video
kind
for
of.
The kind of keyword. You know, just not really afraid of it anymore. It just seems like kind of a fun thing to toy with, you know.
Yeah, I don't think we knew how much we could control how much the video looked or where it went, and you know, have to edit, you know, loads of it out, and so Now we're a little more confident of how we can control it.
If you actually listen to what he says instead of putting words in his mouth, it sounds more like he was against the idea of making stereotypical MTV-style videos. And guess what? They never did that. One is the most anti-MTV music video ever made. It was a complete contrast to the glammy, overproduced cornball bullshit that plagued MTV at the time. They never made stereotypical MTV-style music videos after that either. Enter Sandman is a fucking epileptic seizure on film. The Unforgiven is arguably even darker than the video for one. And Nothing Else Matters was just reworked footage from their documentary that this review has stolen a lot from. And the rest of the videos for the Black Album was just reworked live footage, which isn't that much different from their 80s bootlegs anyway. It also sounds like he didn't quite understand what videos were about. He didn't know they could have so much control over how their videos were presented. And once they broke that cherry and realized how useful of a tool it could be to present their music, they were more comfortable with it, which is why you saw such a huge uptick in videos from the Black Album onwards. Based on all my research here, the selling out by making a video bullshit is just that. Bullshit. One of the biggest arguments that these sellout parrots make is that Metallica did all the things they said they'd never do. Well, I'm sorry. They were never against what they did on the Black Album or anything that came before it. And they never said they wouldn't slow down or simplify their sound. There's an interview with the band before even fucking Kill 'Em All was released where they express a desire to play slower songs.
Most of the songs we have in the fucking pipeline are like at more moderate speeds, you know, we don't really have any super metal militia speeds songs lined up, you know. Just fast songs after a while tend to sound the same, you know, if you have, you know, 25 fast songs, you know.
Yeah, with double bass, all of them, you know. Yeah.
They were never really against what they did during the Load era either.
You know, it's just us doing, you know, what we do, being comfortable and being ourselves, and there's not a huge false front put up, you know, or, you know, like things hanging out here on the underlids of our eyes or anything like that, or, hey.
If you came here to see fucking makeup and hairspray and all this crap, this ain't the fucking band!
Aw, oh, fuck.
Ladies and gentlemen, we got him.
Oh, shit. Well, it looks like I'm had. Metallica actually did something they were initially against. They said they're not the band that wears makeup, and they eventually did. I'm had. You got me.
Good. Serves you right for being a poser. Go cry some more.
I'm crying a lot. But these tears are tears of laughter.
What?
Because just like everything else, the argument that they sold out here completely falls apart the second you actually think about it. Yep, I'm saying it. The image change and genre change on Load was not a sellout move.
But how can you say that, Mike? Metallica literally became what they were against.
Well, once again, that's what it looks like on the surface. And this is the part of the video where I teach you about context. What were Lars and James referring to when they said these things? I'll give you a hint. They were referring to glam metal. When James said this at Day on the Green, he was referring to Rat and Y&T, two big glam metal bands that were going on after Metallica that day. When Lars said this, he was referring to the entire glam metal scene, which was massive at the time. They were referring to glam metal, which Metallica never became. However, if you want to accuse me of putting words in their mouths and interpret what they said literally, here, the sellout argument still falls apart. Why? Well, gather around, kids, and let me explain. Metallica said these things right around the mid-80s. These pictures were taken 10 years later in 1996. And that's why this isn't a sellout move. Because in the 10 years between these two things, Metallica did this thing called
growing the fuck up!
Now, I understand that growing up is an incredibly foreign concept to a lot of metalheads, so let me explain what it entails. As you get older, you change. Your attitudes change. Your tastes change. That includes your tastes in fashion, your tastes in hairstyle, your taste in movies, TV shows, and of course, your taste in music. The point I'm making here is that most of us are not the same people at 33 that we were at 23, and Metallica is no exception. I know I'm not the same person I was when I was 18. My hair is thinner and I'm way fatter now. I don't think Metallica should be given the sellout label just because they went against whatever crap they said when they were still boys full of piss and vinegar. Now, there's one interview with James where he said he wasn't happy about the whole image thing they did in this era, and he just went along with it. You could say he sold out by going along with it, but you forget that Metallica is a fucking band. If Lars, Kirk, and Jason wanted to do it, then sorry, 3-1. And if you actually look at James during this, he's still definitely James. I don't think he was ever against wearing leather jackets and dressing like a damn cowboy. They did not sell out with the image change. They didn't sell out with the fucking music they played during this era either. Now, when you consider the popularity of alternative rock in the 90s, it's not far-fetched to think Metallica was trying to capitalize on it. So I get why it's considered a sellout move. However, say it with me, folks. The argument falls apart as soon as you start to think about it. You know why the sellout argument falls apart? Because they incorporated the influences they had at the time.
I mean, we listen to, you know, your neighbor.
We're musicians, we like music.
There was like a few years, like, you know, 81, 82 was like, if it isn't motor, but then we just started broadening our horizons.
So some of the more interesting things that are happening now in metal are bands who have like embraced a lot of this new technology. A lot of bands who have like used the industrial type of thinking and used it in a heavy metal context.
I actually like the Portishead album. I think that's a great album. Portishead and Radiohead. I like the new Deftones album.
Rage Against the Machine is still pretty tough, I think.
Yes, they changed their musical style. They weren't playing thrash metal anymore. They were playing alternative metal. They didn't do this to cash in on the scene. They did it because that's what they wanted to do. They evolved with the times and made music based on their influences, which had also evolved. However, if you don't agree with me there, that's okay. But if you think that a musician sells out if they change to a more popular genre based on their contemporary influences, then I'd like to play you this song. This is a nice little early 60s doo-wop number called An Angel Is Missing by Ronnie and the Redcaps.
An angel is missing from heaven tonight.
Do you recognize that absolutely beautiful voice?
They'll see that I'm right.
Well, you should, because the guy singing this song is none other than Ronnie James Dio. He is the Ronnie in Ronnie and the Redcaps. This metal wizard himself, one of the greatest singers in heavy metal history, started out as a fucking doo-wop singer. This was the early 60s, when this genre was pretty big. As the 60s progressed and rock and roll underwent massive changes, so did Dio. His little doo-wop project eventually evolved into a hard rock band by the name of Elf based on what his influences were at the time.
So what was your introduction into rock and roll?
Presley.
Right.
I loved all the old R&B singers as well. Sam Cooke, Jackie Wilson,
yeah.
Sam and Dave, James Brown. Those people were very influential to me.
Well, I believe that you, around that time, you with one of the records, first records it produced, actually produced by members of Deep Purple. They must have been pretty impressed because it was John Lord, I believe, who helped you out with that. Is that right?
It was actually Roger Glover and Ian Paice.
Roger and Ian.
Yes. That was, you know, one of my all-time favorite bands anyway, even though you won't see any songs from that time.
We mentioned Black Sabbath a few minutes ago as one of the greats there. And, you know, what was your introduction to those guys, first of all?
Well, really just, you know, listening, I knew, of course, what they had done and, you know, loved the songs and loved the riffs that they did and this kind of such an incredibly dark presence.
So if you think that an artist evolving their style and changing their genre and image based on what their influences were at the time is selling out, then I guess you have to call Ronnie James Dio a sellout. But you won't, because no self-respecting metalhead will ever consider this metal god, the guy who gave us the fucking devil horns, a sellout. And if Ronnie James Dio isn't a sellout, then neither is Metallica for doing the exact same fucking thing. I deeply apologize. I'm really trying to avoid all the whataboutisms, but I just can't do that when Metallica is constantly getting singled out for doing things that most bands and musicians do. They made Load and Reload because those were the albums they wanted to make at the time. If you think Load and Reload are complete fucking garbage, that's okay. But making an album you don't like does not make Metallica a sellout.
Oh, come on, Mike. You're such a Metallica fanboy. They can do no wrong in your eyes.
I knew that accusation was coming. Well, since Metal Douche brought it up, I'm gonna say it right now. No, I am not a blind fanboy. Metallica is not paying me to make this video. There are plenty of things they've done that I completely disagree with and fucking despise. Why don't we go through those things? Number one, they use Dave Mustaine's riffs on Kill 'Em All and Ride the Lightning, despite Dave telling them not to use said riffs. Using those riffs after being told not to is a douchey move. Number two, they treated Jason Newsted like utter garbage. They turned his bass down on Justice, limited him to 3 songwriting credits in 15 fucking years, and then totally fucked him over when he was trying to get out the creativity that they actively suppressed. I know they were grieving over Cliff, and I know losing Cliff was devastating, but that is no excuse to treat his replacement like a burning bag of shit. Granted, they learned from this, and it seems like they treat Robert Trujillo way better, but it's still completely fucking despicable what they put Jason through. Number 3. While I don't think Load and Reload were sellout albums or particularly bad albums, it would have been much better if they combined both albums and cut out all the garbage tracks. Number 4. Saint Anger was a poorly executed mess. Number 5. Death Magnetic. While it's a great album musically, in my opinion, it has the production quality of a fucking ear rape. Number 6. This fucking worthless piece of shit. What the fuck is this? Who in their fucking right mind would consider this bullshit to be fucking listenable? No, I'm not talking about Lulu. I'm talking about this. What the goddamn fucking fuck is this stupid fucking shit being fucking played in my fucking ear? Okay, I'm getting a little mean-spirited towards the band and getting off topic, but the point I'm trying to make is that no, I'm not some fucking blind Metallica fanboy who eats everything they do up. There are plenty of legitimate reasons to shit all over this band. I'm not arguing against them being assholes. I'm arguing against them being sellouts.
Well, what about Napster, Mike?
Oh, fuck! I really don't want to open up this can of worms because there's enough bullshit here for its own hour-long video, so I'll leave it at this. Fighting for artists' rights is not selling out. Metallica has always been a band that has wanted total control over their music and how it's presented.
The issue wasn't about streaming, the issue wasn't about the internet, the issue wasn't about downloading, the issue wasn't about file sharing, the issue was whose choice is it?
Also, they didn't sue their own fans like people will make you believe. They just got those fans' accounts deleted. Still kind of a douchey move, but they did not sue their own fans. Anyways, going after Napster was not a sellout move. Next. So for some fucking reason, there are moments in the Saint Anger era that are considered selling out by some fans. Take this radio promo they did, for example.
In order to suck both
nationwide radio chains off. We are now standing here having to do this fucking stupid thing.
Sharpen that booger picking finger.
I'm about to stick 50 grand up your ass.
Now, they're the biggest chain in America. You know, it's like 75, 80 stations or something. So, strategically.
Why are we doing it then? Just to make them happy?
Yes, that's exactly what they're doing. And they won't say, fuck you. You never do anything for us. We're gonna fuck you on the next record.
When Cliff Bernstein tells them that radio stations will, quote, fuck them on the next record, what he says is that recording this promo in a roundabout way promotes sane anger. And if promoting your fucking album before it's released is selling out, then I guess every fucking musician that's ever existed in the history of the goddamn fucking world is a sellout. And who knows? Maybe they didn't even follow through with it after all. I don't know. There's not much information on this contest outside of the Some Kind of Monster doc. And even if they did eventually record this shitty promo, it was after Cliff Bernstein advised them on it. It's not like he held a steel dildo to their heads. They could have taken it or left it right there. There's also this bullshit that they made Sane Anger to cash in on the nu metal trend. First of all, listen to what Bob Rock says here.
The idea is it should sound like a band getting together in a garage for the first time. Only the band's Metallica.
That's the kind of album they were trying to make. They weren't trying to cash in on the nu metal trend. They were trying to be a fucking garage band. Second of all, listen to this conversation.
You started talking about the idea of the guitar solo as we have known it, maybe being something that was a little outdated.
But can I say something that I think is bullshit? This what? Whole fucking solo out, you know, dates the whole thing. That's so bullshit. If you don't play a guitar solo in one of these songs, that dates it to this period. I think that's stupid. Yeah, I think it's totally trendy.
I think it should serve what's going down. Like, in other words, there shouldn't be like a rule of no solos. There shouldn't be a rule of solos.
The only person here who said removing guitar solos was, quote, trendy, was Kirk himself. Lars thought guitar solos were a thing of the past, and Bob Rock thought the songs didn't call for them. It doesn't sound like they wanted to be System of a Down here. It sounds more like they wanted to try something new, which is completely in character for the band. I don't think cutting Kirk's balls off on this album was a sellout move. More of a failed experiment than anything. Now, going back to that fucking rap song with Swiss Beats and Ja Rule, apparently, that's a sellout. First of all, it's definitely not a sellout move because it implies that this was meant to appeal to a wide audience, and no wide audience would ever fucking like this fucking shit. Now, I know that combining rap with metal instantly makes you worse than Hitler, according to all you elitist troglodytes, but combining the two genres does not make you a sellout. Regardless of the quality, it was still something they wanted to do. Apparently, they fucking sold out with Death Magnetic 2, because they weren't moving forward anymore and were instead retreading old ground to appeal to their old fans. Really? You people bitched and bitched and bitched like a thought going through her first period about everything Metallica did from 91 onwards, and now when they make something similar to their 80s stuff, you're still gonna have a stick up your ass?
What do you want?
It's not that simple.
What do you want?
Do you know how Death Magnetic came about? It was because Rick Rubin convinced them that they could revisit their old selves.
The reconnecting with the past is something that definitely happened organically. Rick made us comfortable about revisiting and being maybe inspired by some of the records we put out in the 80s.
They didn't do it to appease fans. They did it because that was the album they wanted to make at the time. Making an album that harkens back to your olden days does not make you a sellout. All right, so what's the next sellout thing? Guitar Hero Metallica? Are you fucking kidding me? Iron Maiden has a game called Ed Hunter, so I guess they sold out. Also, I don't think Metallica was ever against having their likeness in a video game, so there's that. And when you consider the fact that Lars wanted to do this for his kids, agreeing to this project makes total fucking sense. Alright, I think I'm at the end of this sellout crap unless something else popped up.
What about when they played with that poser, Lady Gaga?
Lady Gaga is a self-proclaimed metalhead and grew up an Iron Maiden fan. Next.
What about when they sang Rihanna in that car?
Oh no, they like music that isn't metal? Oh god, they're fucking posers. Jesus Christ. You fucking elitists need to get the fuck over yourselves. Metallica did not sell out with anything.
Thank you. Okay, I know I've gotten long-winded about this sellout stuff in a video that was supposed to be focused on one album, and I apologize for that. However, before I get back to talking about the Black Album, I feel like I should clarify a few things. It's totally possible that they met behind closed doors once a month and some corporate stooge brought in some quarterly reports and said, according to this chart, this is the music you need to play. And then Lars said, all right, we'll fucking do it. I would never argue against that. What I'm arguing is that it's way more probable that Metallica is just a band that did whatever the fuck they wanted to do throughout their whole career. And besides, if Metallica's goal was to appeal to the widest audience possible, then why would they go after Napster? Why would they release a documentary that makes them look like assholes? Why would James act all giddy and happy that Metallica's music is being used to torture prisoners at Guantanamo?
You know, if I heard some Arabic music for 24 hours straight, I think I'd go crazy too. I don't want it to stop. There's a part of me that thinks, that's kind of proud that, hey, they've chosen Metallica as something it's going to affect them.
Why would they willingly cause PR disasters like this if all they cared about was mass appeal? It just doesn't fucking compute. Every decision they ever made were decisions they wanted to make, and they did whatever they wanted to do. And that brings me back to the Black Album. The band took a huge risk to make the changes that they did, and went through absolute hell to get it done. They busted their asses for an entire year, and burned through tons of money to finish this album. Lars, Kirk, and Jason got fucking divorced during the album's production. And yet, despite going through production hell, the album was a complete triumph and launched them to the fucking moon. And that's why I just can't fucking stand it when the Black Album is called a sellout, because it completely trivializes how hard they worked and how much they had to deal with to get it done. And I also can't stand the whole sellout crap with Metallica as a whole, because it undercuts their entire history. This is a band that came from nothing. They went from playing shitty Diamond Head covers in their garage to becoming the biggest band on the planet. So when you call them a sellout, it spits in the face of everything they ever accomplished. And when you call the Black Album a sellout album, you're completely trivializing the massive impact on the metal scene this album had. The Black Album introduced so many people to metal, and has only helped the scene grow. I know that horribly triggers the elitist crowd, because the metal scene growing just means there's more posers or whatever, but the scene growing only helps. Because when more people get into metal, that means more money is spent on metal bands, and those metal bands can still make metal music, and that metal music inspires new generations to get into metal, and make more metal music. The Black Album, regardless of what you think of it, has helped keep metal alive, and that's why I praise it to this very day. And you know what? Even if you disagree with everything I've said, and you think I made a bunch of straw man arguments, and you still feel betrayed by Metallica making the Black Album, guess what? It was 30 fucking years ago! More time has passed between the Black Album and now than the time between the Black Album and the Beatles' debut. Get the fuck over it! Stop fucking polluting every fucking Metallica comment section with this fucking toxic sellout crap! There's plenty of more important things to be pissed off about than a fucking metal band making an album you didn't like 30 fucking years ago! Move on with your fucking life! And if you say, Mike, you weren't there when it happened. You don't know how it felt to be betrayed like that. Well, joke's on you, because while I definitely wasn't there, I've definitely seen plenty of my favorite bands make albums I didn't like, and you know what I did? I chose to ignore those things and went on with my fucking life! Alright, I think I made my point with this sellout bullshit. Let's conclude this video. The first thing I said in this video was that the Black Album is the most polarizing album ever made, and it definitely is.
However,
when you look past all of the white noise surrounding this record, what you have is a bona fide work of art, in my opinion. And when I say that people are wrong for calling it a sellout, I'm not saying that those people need to like this album. If you hate it for completely musical reasons, that's well within your right. I can definitely see this from the other side and understand why some people think it's overly simplistic garbage. However, that's not how I feel about the album. That's not how I've ever felt about the album. Another reason I started this project was to see if this
bona fide work of art has stood the test of time, and I'm happy to say it has. Despite how much metal has evolved both musically and even socially in the last 30 years, the Black Album has a timeless quality to it. I've listened to this album God knows how many times while working on this video, and it's still just as epic and as hard-hitting as it was when I heard it the first time 2 decades ago. And while there's definitely a lot of great stuff in modern metal, songs like Enter Sandman and The Unforgiven can easily stand up to the best metal songs we have today. And even 30 years later, I still think this album is a perfect gateway for anyone who wants to get into metal. I know, because it was my gateway. My favorite bands are Iron Maiden and Cannibal Corpse. My favorite album of all time is Morbid Angel's Altars of Madness. My favorite album of 2019 was In Coulter's Fatal Visions. My favorite album of 2020 is Abyss by Unleash the Archers. My favorite albums so far this year are Violence Unimagined by Cannibal Corpse, Killgrid by Enforced, Seven Evils Spawned of Seven Heads by Swamp Beast, The Witcher's Cursed Be Thy Kingdom, and Sumo Psycho's Initiation. I would not know any of this music even fucking existed if it wasn't for the Black Album. The Black Album was the first metal album I ever owned. I remember listening to it for the first time in my teens and completely falling in love with it. It led me on a lifelong journey through this music that I would have never gone on had Metallica never opened that door. And I'm sure I'm not the only one. Is the Black Album the best metal album of all time? Hell no. Is it my favorite album of all time? Definitely not. It's not even my favorite Metallica album. It may not be the best metal record ever made, but it is, to me, one of the most important. You don't have to like it. You can think it's complete reprehensible filth, and that's totally fine. You have a right to how you feel. But no matter how much you hate it, you cannot deny its legacy. It has opened a door for metal. A door that has stayed open and let so many people in for 3 decades. And I'm eternally grateful for that. Metallica's Black Album may not have earned everyone's love, but as far as I'm concerned, it has definitely earned everyone's respect. Maybe it's time we all start giving it.
Commercial is a funny word to use as an insult, because being commercial just means the more people bought your music, which is what you're trying to do when you set out to make most people as possible hear your music. That's why you do it, you know?
We do what we want to do, you know? If they consider that selling out, then whatever.
You either embrace change, or you're afraid of it, and you turn around and kind of maybe stay the same size, or don't grow at all.
The great thing about Metallica, when they make a decision, they commit fully to it. So even though a lot of things that I brought to them, they embrace, and they do it full on.
I think we knew we had some pretty good songs with this new album, and it was just a matter of kind of molding them to exactly how we wanted them in the studio and basically getting them on tape.
There were a lot of planets aligning. It was the right songs with the right new producer, with the right new attitude, with the right new recording approach, with the right timing.
After we got together the 12 songs, we knew that we had something special.
It just came from a place that was obviously very magical. You just can't argue with the song.
For us, it was a long, slow build, and we built up a family that cared about us and not weren't there just for the fad, you know? We had built it up, and it felt good to get the recognition with the Black Album.
To actually see it come into realization was very special, and was the best feeling you possibly had.
When the album started selling the way it did, I could not believe it.
I still feel that the album has turned out about 1,000 times better than I'd ever hoped for.
Read out the 4 albums that have been on the Billboard charts for 500 weeks or more. Well, one of those is Metallica's Black Album.
To have one record like that in your career is amazing. It's really amazing.